Hello, I'm Mihaela van der Schaar, and it is my great pleasure to give this invited talk today in the NeurIPS 2021 workshop on meta-learning. Usually, when we think about meta-learning in the machine learning community, we think about computer algorithms transferring knowledge across tasks and domains to efficiently learn new tasks, optimizing the machine learning process itself, and even generating new machine learning methods from scratch. So we think about how computers learn. However, in this talk today, I will go back to the origins of the meta-learning field, which focuses on human learning rather than computer learning, and discuss how we can use machine learning to empower human learning and meta-learning. I will also introduce a new branch of machine learning developed in our lab, which enables this. We refer to it as quantitative epistemology. Donald Maudsley, the father of meta-learning, defined it as the process by which learners, human learners, become aware of and increasingly in control of habits of perception, inquiry, learning, and growth. In the talk today, for illustration, we are going to focus on how clinicians meta-learn and make decisions. But the discussion and the methods that I'm going to describe are very generally applicable to a variety of human learners. Maudsley has defined five principles that learners must adopt to do meta-learning. They must have a theory, discover their rules and assumptions, reconnect with reality information from the environment, reorganize themselves by changing their rules and assumptions, and work in a supportive environment. But it is hard for humans to do such meta-learning tasks. So it is our goal to develop a new machine learning field aimed at empowering humans. We plan to use machine learning to improve human meta-learning as well as decision-making of humans. And for this, we have developed quantitative epistemology. Epistemology is the study of knowledge, and quantitative refers to the things that can be measured. So let us see what we can do with quantitative epistemology to enable the new human-machine partnership. First, we can build the theory that Maudsley is talking about for doing meta-learning for humans. So humans act and perform meta-learning, perception, inquiry, learning, decisions, and quantitative epistemology can extract from this information assumptions, structures, rules, and changes, and distill hypotheses about meta-learning. We can in this way build a theory of meta-learning, which can then be reconnected with reality information from the environment and can be improved continuously. On the basis of this theory, we can then generate advice for humans that can empower them. Then humans can grow and can improve their abilities and capabilities to perform meta-learning as well as take better decisions. As I'm going to show a little bit later in my talk, we are going to see how we can use quantitative epistemology to enable clinicians to distill information about their decision-making process to understand better how they view decision-making for diagnosis, what is their flexibility, optimism, adaptability. And on the basis of this, we are going to extract some hypotheses, some of them surprising, such as the fact that clinicians are overly pessimistic when diagnosing patients at risk, as well as optimism and confirmation bias lead to behavior that is similar but can be distinguished. And this will lead to hypotheses for the theory of meta-learning that needs to be better understood, such as why are some clinicians overly pessimistic towards such at-risk patients? If we understand this, then we can generate advice for humans and new guidelines to enable them to correct such biases. In this way, diagnosis and decisions of clinicians are going to be improved. Maudsley also mentioned, besides the theory of human learning, that there is a need for building supportive environments to support the meta-learning of humans. So as humans are acting and making decisions, quantitative epistemology can distill this information in the form of meta-learning models, identifying potential biases and errors, as well as inconsistency in decision-making, and generate new advice. Humans can take this information into consideration then and provide implicit and explicit feedback to quantitative epistemology. For instance, through their actions that may be changing over time, they provide implicit feedback. And by providing information such as adjustments and corrections, clarifications, or ratings of the advice provided by quantitative epistemology, provide explicit feedback to adapt it, thereby creating a supportive environment for humans on the basis of their feedback. At the first sight, this may look like yet another decision support system, but this is not the case. Quantitative epistemology is a paradigm shift in the human-machine interaction. Decision support provides action recommendations to decision makers before they make a particular decision. Instead, quantitative epistemology provides decision makers continuously with one-time information about mistakes they may make, systematic errors. It enables them to validate their intent in these decisions. It makes them more aware of the way in which they learn and react to a variety of information sources. It enables them to avoid cognitive biases, and it can even recommend to them training. This is, for instance, the case if the decision makers are clinicians. Stakeholders in the decision-making process can be others as well. For instance, in the clinical setting, stakeholders could be patients, which need to understand the reasons behind the decisions being made by a clinician on their behalf. They also need to ensure that the right decision is made on their behalf. So quantitative epistemology can assist such stakeholders after a decision is made, as well as continuously as stakeholders and decision makers interact. This is also useful for supervisors and managers, which can detect systematic errors, analyze variation in practice and in decision making. They can monitor behavior, they can recommend training, and this can be done continuously. Policymakers can assess current practices and measure the impact of new policies. This can be done both before and after introducing new policies. For instance, new clinical practice guidelines. Trainers and teachers can find best ways to present information and knowledge to the decision makers, and they can assess how much is learned over time, providing a personalized and continuous learning plan. Researchers, and here when I talk about researchers, I talk about social science researchers, education researchers, as well as meta-learning researchers such as Maudsley, can analyze behavioral data and behavioral decision-making of the stakeholders, of the decision makers, as well as form hypotheses about meta-learning, contribute to decision-making theory, and this can be done during the scientific process, after data collection, as well as before experimentation with new methods and theories. Existing machine learning methods offer, though, limited help in providing such insights. For instance, in the forward problem, the focus is on optimal policies and focuses on deriving such optimal policies, for instance, using reinforcement learning with the overall goal of outperforming humans and human replacement. Also, in the inverse reinforcement learning problem, the focus is on human imitation or apprenticeship learning, with the overall focus of empowering machines that can imitate humans rather than empowering the humans themselves. Instead, quantitative epistemology is focused on human empowerment. A first step in this agenda is our work on inverse decision modeling, or for short, IDM, which represents a general framework for learning representations of human meta-learning and decision-making behavior. It enables us to describe existing behavior relative to an ideal normative behavior. So what do we mean by this? Normativity is the phenomenon of designating some actions or outcomes as good, desirable, or permissible. For instance, in clinical decision making, this may be a golden standard of clinical diagnosis. A normative ideal, then, is a standard for evaluating of making judgments about behavior of outcomes. And we have developed this particular work on inverse decision modeling with my two PhD students, Dan Jarrett and Alihan Huyuk. This work was presented at ICML 2021. Inverse decision modeling is a type of inverse analysis that infers a representation from the existing behavior. In this way, it goes well beyond what has been done so far in machine learning to empower humans. In order to do so, it leverages the normative ideal, which describes what the human agent or the community think is the best way to solve the decision-making problem at hand. Since the behavior representation obtained by inverse decision modeling is given with respect to this normative ideal, we can easily use it to generate prescriptive advice for humans that would guide them towards the normative ideal they selected. This advice could come in the form of new guidelines, for instance. On the basis of this new advice and new guidelines, the existing behavior would, of course, change, after which we can use IDM again to infer a representation of that new behavior and issue new advice. In this way, we can keep improving human behavior into a feedback cycle. So, how can we model the agent's behavior? We use the standard decision-making setup. Here, at each time step, the agent is in some internal state Z, and they take an action determined by some decision policy. Their action causes the environment to transit into a new external state S and emit an observation, which the agent uses to update its internal state according to some recognition policy. For instance, the forward planner may want to find a policy that would optimize an objective determined by a given set of planning parameters. For instance, in the standard reinforcement learning setup, that objective could be the expected cumulative utility or the value function. But here, note, we are interested in the planning problems of interest to humans. For instance, how to perform correct early diagnosis by humans, given the available information they can acquire. So we are going to focus on this particular problem later to illustrate and anchor the key ideas. But how can we do that? How do we know and to do inverse decision modeling? Suppose we are given demonstration of the agent's existing policies in our data set, and we partition the planning parameters into a normative and a descriptive part. An inverse planner then aims to find the descriptive part of the planning parameters given the normative part, such that the behavior induced by the two is as close as possible to the demonstrated behavior from the data set. A better way to conceptualize this operation is to think of it as the projection of the demonstrated behavior, the behavior available in the dataset, onto the space of behaviors that all satisfy the same normative standards. In our framework, those normative standards are specified in the form of a forward planner and a fixed set of normative planning parameters. What we have been calling so far as inverse decision modeling is essentially this projection operation. This formulation not only subsumes a wide range of existing algorithms in machine learning and reinforcement learning, but it also opens up new possibilities for interpretative research on decision-making behavior. So this will enable us to formalize in this way our work on human meta-learning. We have argued so far for a systematic, unifying perspective on inverse decision modeling for behavior representation learning. We now consider a concrete example of this formalism. This is going to be inverse bounded rational control. And we are going to highlight three aspects of this approach. Interpretability, since IBRC gives a transparent parameterization of behaviors that can be successfully learned from observational data. Expressivity, since IBRC more finely differentiates between imperfect behaviors of humans, while standard reward learning cannot. and applicability, where inverse decision modeling, inclusively inverse bounded rational control, can be used in real-world setting as an investigative device for understanding human decisions. Let us start by describing a bounded rational planner as part of our normative specification to better understand these ideas. We will assume that the agent has uncertain knowledge of their environment, for instance, a clinician making a diagnosis on behalf of their patient, which is given as a prior over the transition and emission dynamics. However, we will allow the agent to deviate from this prior based on their internal state according to some specification policy. Assuming that the agent would have performed Bayesian inference as their recognition policy if they were to know their environment perfectly, the overall recognition of the agent could be described as an aggregate of such inferences weighted according to their specification policy. Then, the bounded rational planner, the human, aims to maximize expected cumulative utility, much like in the standard reinforcement learning planning problem, but with additional constraints on how the human's decision, specification, and recognition policies can deviate from some pre-specified priors. The motivation behind these constraints is that human rationality, as well as learning, is similarly bounded. Solving such an optimization problem leads us to a value iteration rule that is familiar from reinforcement learning, except that in this case, because we deal with humans, we will have additional complexity terms discouraging deviations from prior decision, specification, and recognition policies. We take how freely the human learner can deviate from the prior decision policy as a measure of his flexibility, how freely he can deviate from the prior specification policy as a measure of his optimism, and how freely he can deviate from the prior recognition policy as a measure of his adaptivity. So, given that this bounded rational agent, the human, optimizes a specified reward or utility function, how optimal does he appear to behave? For this, we are going to take a specific example, that of medical diagnosis. And the reason we take this example is because medical diagnosis exhibits remarkable regional, institutional, and subgroup variability. And this type of inverse bounded rational control can provide insights into such variation in clinical practice, detecting and quantifying variation and potential biases. And such normative descriptive questions are only possible within the IDM and IBRC framework. They are not possible in the framework of apprenticeship learning or inverse reinforcement learning. In order to see the impact of flexibility, optimism, and adaptivity on behavior, we consider a simple environment for medical diagnosis first, a toy example. In this environment, patients are either disease negative or disease positive, and vital sign measurements are taken every step noisily and in order to assess the patient's underlying disease state. Then, the decision clinicians need to make is whether to keep monitoring a patient and collect more evidence for a diagnosis or to stop and declare a final diagnosis that is negative or positive. Our normative specification of the utility function is simple in this toy example. Correct diagnoses are awarded 10 and incorrect diagnoses minus 36. It costs one to monitor the patient for another time step. Since monitoring is expensive, the question we are asking is, how does the clinician decide whether the value of what is learned outweighs the cost of monitoring? To illustrate the key ideas, we are going to show in every figure the x-axis representing the clinician's subject posterior over their patient's true disease state, and the y-axis will represent the action probabilities. The curves represent the different possible actions, and the red markers show when the posterior is updated as more positive observations are made. A caution here. These are not the belief trajectories over time. These are the belief states. In this first figure, we see the effect of flexibility on behavior. The flexible agent is more willing to wait for information and has a sharp threshold for declaring diagnosis. The inflexible agent is never very certain about his diagnosis because he keeps waiting for more information. He's stuck in his original beliefs. As you can see, the actions of the inflexible agent is much more stochastic compared to the very flexible agent. And this is related to the concept of behavioral inconsistency in psychology. In the next figure, we see the effect of optimism on behavior. While the optimistic agent believes observations to be much more informative than they actually are and update their subjective posterior accordingly, the pessimistic agent believes them to be less informative. And hence, the pessimistic agent makes observations sooner. This is related to the phenomena of over and underreaction. In the final figure, we see the effect of adaptivity on behavior. The non-adaptive agent requires less evidence before he declares a final diagnosis. And the adaptive agent is more willing to wait for new information. And this is related to the concept of base neglect and confirmation bias. Now that we have described the bounded rational planner, we can return back to our original question. How rational does an agent, a human agent, appear to be when pursuing an ideal utility function? We can formulate inverse bounded rational control as an instance of inverse decision modeling to answer this question. Our forward planner is the bounded rational planner we have just defined. Our normative parameter is the utility function that we consider to be ideal given the decision-making problem we analyze. And our descriptive parameters are the measures of flexibility, optimism, and adaptivity we have just discussed. And as an example, we are indeed able to infer from data how flexible an agent is using inverse bounded rational control. To illustrate how our method can be useful in practice, we are going to consider the decision-making problem of diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease by ordering MRI. While an MRI is often informative of Alzheimer's, it is also financially costly. And we are going to try to understand progression to Alzheimer, which is often done in three stages: normal function, mild cognitive impairment, and dementia. And this constitutes the state space. And observations are cognitive test results and MRIs of patients. For this, we are going to consider decision-making in the ADNI dataset and understand variation in practice. So we are going to try to understand when clinicians have ordered an MRI to diagnose early Alzheimer's, given the fact that ordering an MRI is costly. First, we recover the optimism parameter for all the patients at once from the ADNI dataset. Then we did the same for different subgroups of patients. And what we quantified is that the clinicians appear to be significantly less optimistic when diagnosing patients with the APOE4 genetic risk factors, female patients, and patients over the age of 75, which also happen to be the patients which are more at risk. If we think about the previous graphs related to optimism, we note that this is not a matter of priors, but a matter of posteriors. The pessimistic clinicians request a new MRI at lower values of their posterior. The IDM framework I just described here is very general and enables us to look at a variety of other settings. Some of them that are part of our earlier work in the quantitative epistemology agenda. For instance, we looked at how timely is agent decision-making, where agents again are humans. What reward functions does the humans optimize? How important are various counterfactuals in the decision maker's opinion? What are the subjective beliefs of humans? How optimal is human behavior relative to an ideal reward function? And how does human behavior and learning evolve over time? In order to pursue this agenda, we have developed new machine learning models for planning strategies as well as learning strategies. So the inverse decision modeling agenda requires us to develop a variety of new machine learning methods. But to go further in the quantitative epistemology agenda, we need to develop machine learning methods that enable us to better understand how humans learn and perform meta-learning. How do they interact with each other? How do they form representations about the knowledge that they acquire over time, etc. So quantitative epistemology is an important piece of creating a new human-machine partnership with the overall goal of empowering humans rather than replace them. This is a very important multidisciplinary research agenda in which we, the machine learning researchers, need to join forces with others from cognitive sciences, education, neuroscience, and many other fields to empower humans. If you are interested to learn more about what we have done in the quantitative epistemology agenda, as well as engage with this agenda, please take a look at our pillar on our website. Thank you very much.